Good morning. For a dropped object experiencing a drag force equal to the proportionality constant times velocity. In a previous lesson, we derived the equations for the position, velocity, and acceleration as a function of time, and the object's terminal velocity. It is important to realize we defined down as positive. Again, down is positive. What we are doing today is defining the time constant. The lowercase Greek letter tau is the symbol for the time constant. And yes, it is the same as the symbol for torque. I am sorry. Let's look specifically at our velocity equation. Billy, please read the velocity as a function of time equation.
Flippin' physics.
Velocity as a function of time equals mass times acceleration due to gravity divided by the proportionality constant times the quantity 1 minus e to the power negative proportionality constant times time over mass.
Thank you, Billy. The way we determine the time constant in this equation is by rearranging the velocity equation slightly to get mass over proportionality constant in the denominator of the exponent. And we can replace mass over proportionality constant with the time constant tau, because in this situation, the time constant tau equals mass over the proportionality constant. The way you determine the time constant is by figuring out what value to put in the denominator of the exponent such that you will get negative t over time constant in the exponent. There are other time constants for other relationships, so realize the time constant equals mass over proportionality constant for this specific example.
But what is the time constant?
Yeah, we will get there. Let's start by determining the units for the time constant. Billy, please?
Okay, the time constant equals mass over proportionality constant. The units then are kilograms over... Does anybody remember what the units for proportionality constant are? I know we figured them out before.
Kilograms per second.
Oh yeah, newtons divided by meters per second equal kilograms per second. That means the units for a time constant are kilograms over kilograms per second, or just seconds. The units for the time constant are seconds.
That makes sense.
But I still do not know what the time constant is.
Right. It is called the time constant. It has units of seconds. And Billy, I'm working on describing the time constant. First, realize we can substitute terminal velocity into our velocity equation. And Bo, please solve for the object's velocity at one time constant, or time equals tau.
Velocity at one time constant, or time equals tau, equals the terminal velocity times the quantity 1 minus e to the power negative time constant over time constant. Time constant over time constant equals 1, and e to the negative 1 equals 0.367879. 1 minus that equals 0.632121. So the velocity at one time constant equals 0.632 times the terminal velocity.
In other words, the time constant is the time it takes for the velocity of the falling object to reach 63.2% of its terminal velocity. The time constant is a general way for us to define the time it takes for an exponential equation to get to 8% of its maximum value. The time constant represents the time it takes for a 63.2% change. For example, after a total of two time constants, the velocity has reached 86.5% of its terminal velocity. This represents, from one to two time constants, another increase of the velocity to 63.2% closer to the terminal velocity.
I'm sorry, what?
After one time constant, you have 0.367879, or 36.7879% remaining. Multiply that by 0.632121 to get 0.232544, which represents roughly 63.2% of the remaining 0.367879. So, from one to two time constants, the terminal velocity increases by roughly 23.3%, which is 63.2% of the remaining 36.8%, which, when added to the original 0.632121, we get 0.864665, or roughly 86.5%. As Mr. P said, each increase in time of one time constant represents an increase in the velocity such that it gets 63.2% closer to its terminal velocity or maximum velocity.
Oh.
Nice clarification, Bo.
Thanks, Mr. P.
After three time constants, the velocity has reached 95.0% of its terminal velocity. Again, an increase which gets the velocity 63.2% closer to the maximum velocity. Each time change of an integer multiple of the time constant gets the value 63.2% closer to the maximum value.
Oh, cool. And we can calculate that it takes roughly... just a second... solve for x. 6.91 time constants to reach 99.9% of its terminal velocity.
Okay, I think I kind of understand what the time constant is. The time constant is a way to express how much time it takes for the object to experience a 63.2% change in its velocity. But that number 63.2 just seems a bit random.
This 63.2% number does keep coming up in our discussion, and 0.632 is actually not a random number. 0.632 is the number you get when you subtract e to the power negative 1 from 1. That expression is in our velocity equation, and you will most likely see it again. For the purposes of the AP Physics C exams and curricula, it is a number you should recognize and know how to determine. One more thing about the time constant. It is a way for us to quantifiably compare the time it takes different objects to reach terminal velocity. For example, a feather is going to have a very small time constant, whereas a hammer would have a much larger time constant. Okay, let's discuss what the time constant means for acceleration. Billy, please look at the acceleration equation and plug in one time constant for time to see what happens.
Okay, acceleration is a function of time for an object in free fall that starts with an initial velocity of 0 equals acceleration due to gravity times e to the power. Well, in terms of time constants, it is just negative time over time constant. When we plug in one time constant for time, we get e to the power negative time constant over time constant, or e to the negative 1, or 0.367879, or 0.368 times the acceleration due to gravity. But what does that mean? Well, the initial acceleration of the ball at time equals 0 equals acceleration due to gravity times e to the power negative 0 over the time constant. E to the power 0 equals 1, so the initial acceleration of the ball equals the acceleration due to gravity. Okay, I see it. During one time constant, the acceleration of the ball has decreased from the acceleration due to gravity to 0.368 times the acceleration due to gravity. In other words, the acceleration of the ball has decreased by 63.2%, because that is what the time constant represents, a change of 63.2%. There's that number again, 63.2.
Yep. As I said, 0.632 is going to come up a lot when it comes to the time constant. Now let's look at the y position as a function of time equation. You can see that we can isolate out mass times acceleration due to gravity divided by proportionality constant or terminal velocity. We get that the y position as a function of time of the ball equals terminal velocity times time, plus terminal velocity times time constant, times the quantity e to the power negative time over time constant minus 1. Now, at time equals 0, the initial position of the ball equals 0. We can also determine the y position of the ball after one time constant. Again, time constant over time constant equals 1. And e to the power negative 1 equals 0.367879. That means that the y position of the ball after one time constant equals roughly 0.368 times terminal velocity times the time constant. So, while this does not have the same shape as the velocity and acceleration, there are some similarities which are easiest to see when we look at the graphs of these functions, starting with velocity. But actually, we are not going to graph velocity as a function of time. We are going to rearrange the formula and graph something slightly different. We are going to divide both sides by terminal velocity to get velocity as a function of time over terminal velocity. Let's call this a dimensionless velocity ratio and put that on the y-axis. On the x-axis, let's put time divided by time constant, or a dimensionless time ratio. The graph looks like this. Bobby, tell me what you see when you look at the graph.
Okay. So it is a graph of a dimensionless velocity ratio as a function of a dimensionless time ratio? That's just weird.
I know, Bobby. Please just tell me what you see on the graph.
Well, when time equals one time constant, on the x-axis we have time constant over time constant, so we are at the number one on the x-axis. At this point, the velocity has reached 63.2% of the terminal velocity. Right, so that is why the y-axis value at this point is 0.632.
There is that number again.
Right. When time equals two time constants, the y-axis value is 0.865 because the velocity has reached 86.5% of its terminal velocity. When the time equals seven time constants, the y-axis value should be roughly 0.999 because the velocity has reached roughly 99.9% of its terminal velocity. The curve has a horizontal asymptote at one because the maximum velocity which the object will reach is the terminal velocity, v sub t, and terminal velocity over terminal velocity equals one. Actually, those dimensionless ratios on the axes make sense because then the y-axis goes from 0 to 1 and represents going from 0 to 100% of the terminal velocity, and the x-axis goes into increments of time constants.
Very nice, Bobby. Thanks. Now let's rearrange the acceleration equation to get acceleration as a function of time over acceleration due to gravity equals e to the power negative time over time constant. Now we are going to graph acceleration as a function of time over acceleration due to gravity, or a dimensionless acceleration ratio, as a function of the same time over time constant, or the dimensionless time ratio. The graph looks like this. And, Bo, tell me what you see.
Sure. After one time constant, the y-axis is at 0.368 because the acceleration has decreased by 63.2%. After seven time constants, the y-axis is at roughly 0.001 because the acceleration has decreased by roughly 99.9%. The curve has a horizontal asymptote of zero because the minimum acceleration is zero and zero over g equals zero. Okay, so the y-axis has values between 0 and 1 and represents the percent of the acceleration due to gravity that the object is experiencing after however many time constants.
Thanks, Bo. Lastly, let's look at position. Again, we rearrange the equation. This time we are going to divide the whole equation by terminal velocity times the time constant. And we get y position as a function of time over the quantity terminal velocity times time constant equals time over time constant, plus e to the power negative time over time constant, all minus 1. We are creating a graph of position as a function of time over the quantity terminal velocity times the time constant, or a dimensionless position ratio, as a function of again, the same time over time constant, or the dimensionless time ratio. The graph looks like this. Billy, tell me what you see.
Absolutely, I can do that. The initial y-axis value is 0 because the initial position is 0. You can see that when we plug 0 in for time t into the equation. The curve actually asymptotes to a slope of 1. Oh, that's cool. That means that as the velocity approaches its terminal velocity, the displacement traveled during each time constant approaches the terminal velocity times the time constant. That makes total sense because velocity equals change in position over change in time. Therefore, terminal velocity equals the displacement during one time constant over the change in time of one time constant, which means the displacement during one time constant equals the terminal velocity times the time constant. That's exactly what a slope of one on this graph means. Oh, and the y-axis actually is a dimensionless position ratio because y position as a function of time over the quantity terminal velocity times time constant actually is dimensionless because terminal velocity times time constant is a distance. Wow.
Well done, Billy. Let's take a moment to compare the graphs to one another. Recall that the slope of position as a function of time is velocity. That is why the initial slope of the position graph is zero, because the initial velocity of the object is zero, and zero divided by terminal velocity equals zero. The final slope of the position graph is one, because the velocity graph asymptotes to one. Also, we know the slope of velocity as a function of time is acceleration. That is why the initial slope of the velocity graph is 1, because the initial acceleration of the object is the acceleration due to gravity, and acceleration due to gravity divided by acceleration due to gravity equals 1. The final slope of the velocity graph is 0, because the final acceleration is 0, and 0 divided by acceleration due to gravity equals 0. That is my discussion of time constant and the drag force. Thank you very much for learning with me today. I enjoyed learning with you. I'm sorry. Actually, I do want to add one last thing. Notice that all of the motion graphs we are working with here have the identifying characteristics of the object removed from them. All that is left is the time constant. By using dimensionless ratios on both the y and x axes, we are able to graph generic functions for any object which starts with an initial velocity of zero, is being acted on by a constant force, and also has a drag force acting on it, which has a magnitude of proportionality constant times velocity. So, no matter what object you are analyzing, as long as it starts with an initial velocity of zero, is acted upon by a constant force, and it also has a drag force with a magnitude of proportionality constant times velocity acting on it, these graphs are applicable to the motion of that object, which I think is pretty darn cool. In fact, there are other situations which have these exact same graphs. For example, the charge on a capacitor in an RC circuit, or a circuit with a resistor, capacitor, and power source. If the initial charge of the capacitor is zero, after the switch is closed, the charge on the capacitor as a function of time over the maximum charge of the capacitor equals 1 minus e to the power negative time over time constant. That gives the same expression as the velocity graph we just had. That means that after one time constant, the capacitor in an RC circuit has reached 63.2% of its maximum charge. And just like acceleration equals the derivative of velocity as a function of time, current equals the derivative of charge as a function of time. So the equation for current as a function of time over maximum current in an RC circuit equals e to the negative time over time constant and has the exact same function as our acceleration graph. I'll stop there.
Oh, yeah. Mr. P, come on. Can we do a little more?
Thanks for learning with me.